before you ever start. Some will say the journey's just too hard. Somewhere between right here and the other side, there will be fear and doubt in the deep dark night. But we
this is the 7th annual Tour de Turtles. Every year it gets bigger and better and more popular, especially thanks to all of our incredible sponsors such as Disney, who's been with us from the very beginning.
Well, Disney has a very strong commitment to conservation, specifically sea turtles. We decided to build a resort here on the Treasure Coast. And in that effort, we wanted to make sure that we became truly custodians of the environment and of the conservation effort. And it really became part of the culture of the resort. Our guests return with us. They really become part of the family of taking an interest in what sea turtles conservation really is. And they stay committed to it. And we're always very proud of that. We're proud to continue the tradition. And we're really interested in moving ahead and making it a great place for sea turtles to nest and to sustain themselves.
Having opportunities like Tour de Turtles and other nature-based events is really important for kids and families because it helps to develop lifelong conservation values. And it's the next generation that will ensure the survival of these endangered animals.
The sea turtle story is so inspiring to me because they have to struggle to get out of the nest and then struggle to get to the ocean and then struggle their entire lives in the ocean. And I know that I can't help very much with that aspect, but I can help reduce the human impact on them. And that inspires me to learn more about them and learn how to help them.
Thank you.
having the opportunity to track them online for months or even a year at a time lets people stay connected with these animals even after they leave the beach or if they never get a chance to come see one in person. So it's a great tool to educate, make people aware, and get them concerned about the fate of these amazing animals.
Any time that anybody can spend in nature is great for your soul, and it's great for how you think about protecting nature in the future.
LEAF stands for Leaders in Environmental Action for the Future, and these young people represent our future. The investment in our youth for today is extremely important for tomorrow. Two scrub jays just flew over our head and landed in that tree right there.
LEAF is a project of the Nature Conservancy. They work with a variety of environmental educational schools. We select different students from these schools to come out and actually get immersed in nature. They've been learning about invasive species, the endemic scrub jay, as well as the role the Nature Conservancy plays in helping restore these areas.
This is the propiograph.
We are at the Disney Wilderness Preserve. Disney purchased the land, gave it to the Nature Conservancy, and gave the funds to help restore it. We've got about 12,000 acres here that connects with a wide variety of other environmental lands.
We're picking up species that are native to this area so we can put it in parts of the preserve where we have invasive species.
When I go back home to Georgia, I'll take away how beautiful nature is and how we should help to conserve it and keep it the way it is so that generations from now can enjoy the same nature that I'm enjoying now.
Remember when we were driving past that deer and the deer was just standing there?
You guys remember that eagle's nest? We were driving past and we saw that alligator.
Remember that hog that wasn't a hog?
And every day is a new experience. You see new animals daily.
It's been a great experience coming out here.
A lot of people my age, you know, they're working in convenience stores or, you know, they're not coming outside and watching scrub jays or dealing with fire management or anything like that. So I think this is really cool to say this is my first job.
It's something I will never forget, and it's so nice to finally say, you know, I have an internship in nature.
The girls have bonded. They really didn't know each other beforehand. So now they have a very unique experience in which they'll be connected forever. So even when they go off to college, when they go back to their friends, when they go back to their family, whatever they do in life, they're going to replicate some of these experiences.
I think I will leave this experience with a whole new outlook on life. Instead of staying indoors and trying to catch the latest thing on TV or get the latest gadgets, I think I'll be more like, let's go outside, let's take a hike, let's go canoeing, let's watch the birds around us.
We're hoping that they get a connection to nature, and that's really important. Once students get connected to nature, they you tend to protect what you connect with or what you know.
When they do that, then nature and the environment will become theirs, and they'll encourage others to protect it by going out and sharing those same experiences and those same memories. Then the next person, the next person, the next person will help to save our environment.
Thank you, Disney and the Nature Conservancy.
Hi everyone, I'm Troop Leader Lori, and I'm here at Disney's Animal Kingdom to share with you our brand new park-wide experience, Wilderness Explorers. Wilderness Wilderness Explorers is a one-of-a-kind adventure, and your adventure begins right here at the Wilderness Explorers headquarters. Here at headquarters, you'll receive your very own Wilderness Explorers handbook and learn how you can earn over 30 badges while exploring Disney's Animal Kingdom. And of course, you'll learn the Wilderness Explorers call and earn your very first badge. Troop Leader Crystal, let's get started earning those badges.
Would you all like to become Wilderness Explorers today?
Yes!
Yes! While earning your badges all over the park, you'll get to do some really fun activities, like dig for fossils, hike the trails, learn about animals and conservation, immerse yourself in new cultures, and explore the natural world all around you. Lots of people at Disney's Animal Kingdom are friends of the Wilderness Explorers. You can tell because they will know the pledge.
The wilderness must be explored! Go, go, roar!
Some of them even help us earn our badges. There are troop leaders set up all over the park to talk to you about the natural world. If you don't earn all of your badges in one visit, that's okay. Save your handbook and continue exploring next time. Earn all of the badges and you'll become a senior wilderness explorer.
Wilderness Explorers, of course, is the scout troop from the Pixar movie Up. And we've made it real at Disney's Animal Kingdom. Because of the underlying ideas of nature at Animal Kingdom, we're very interested in unscripted forms of entertainment. And so Wilderness Explorers allows people this tremendous freedom to move through the park as they please and engage the things at their own speed, at their own will, and yet always come away with a real sense of accomplishment.
Yes, it's a T-Rex!
One of the biggest design challenges for Wilderness Explorers was really, how do we get our guests to get outside and play? How do we get them to explore the park? And how do we get them to engage with our animals? So what we did was we designed activities that could be done while riding Kilimanjaro safaris. It could be done on the way to another attraction. For Wilderness Explorers, we designed a 43-page handbook. And this handbook is great because it helps us to self-direct our guests around the park for their challenges. It's a way for our guests to be fully engaged in a story, but without being distracted from something like a device. So while they're walking around, they're really engaged in the park and enjoying nature. With our 32 cast members stationed around the park, our guests can come up and have a totally custom conversation with any one of these cast members.
So who has frogs by their house?
We aimed this experience to be for children, but what we found out is because this cast member is so highly trained, they're able to level the conversation to all of their interests. So really this little interactive experience has really changed the social dynamic of our park.
The fact that this involves such sincere interactions with people has been really great for our cast members because they get to relate to our guests in a very unpredictable, very organic way. So there's a way in which this game becomes an engine for a very positive emotion.
You are, what a good aspiration, my friends.
I chose the Wilderness Explorers program for my students because it will take the students throughout the entire park. The students will learn about the animals and their habitats. They'll talk to cast members from the countries that are represented. When they came back to school, they were talking about the things they had learned because they earned badges.
You all have officially earned your fossil badge.
They said that everywhere they went in the park, they looked around and saw something that they had learned from the program.
The Wilderness Explorer program at Disney's Animal Kingdom is a great way to engage our younger guests and their families with amazing adventures in our park. The kids get to develop all sorts of skills that scientists and conservationists use each and every day. They're going to be out tracking animals, looking for clues so that we can learn how to protect them. All of these things help kids to have this sort of sense of exploration and adventure.
I made the moon!
And all of this ties into helping us develop future conservation heroes.
Wilderness Explorers is unique for Imagineering because there's no technology to it. It is all story. We're using very, very simple technology, a book, some stickers, and the existing park. And yet, people have responded very strongly.
Yeah.
One of the most exciting things about the feedback we're getting on Wilderness Explorers is parents are so excited that we are unplugging their children. The kids are getting engaged with their parents, and we're finding that gameplay is happening as families. So kids are actually engaged and talking to their parents about these scientific facts.
We did this wanting to do something good for our guests, wanting to add just a little flavor to Animal Kingdom. It's really surprised us and is very exciting in that sense.
One of the most rewarding things that I've gotten from working on the Wilderness Explorer project is when people come back and tell me, I was really surprised because I learned something, or I felt like I was a better person.
You've done it as well, excellent.
Or my kids were engaged in this. And it's always this surprise that they have, that they actually got something out of it besides entertainment.
Yeah,
Disney's Animal Kingdom is not a park just about entertainment. It's really this transformational experience. And as a designer, our goal is to try to make you feel that connection with nature, to try to get you down to that deep feeling that you can do something good in the world and that you actually have power to do so in the world.
Awesome.
And Wilderness Explorers has helped the kids to feel that.
We are extremely happy with the investment that we've made in Wilderness Explorers. Families are now coming in and experiencing the park in a way that they've never done before. They're engaging with animals, they're engaging with cast members, they're learning about conservation, and they're leaving the park with a better experience than they've had before. About 20% of all of our guests that are coming into the park actually stop by our Wilderness Explorers booth and they engage in the program.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So we're exceptionally proud of what we've introduced to our guests, and this is only the beginning.
An explorer is a friend to all, be it plants or fish or tiny mole. The wilderness must be explored. Caw, caw.
This morning, this very beautiful but slightly chilly morning, Disney volunteers, almost 350 people, are gathering to be part of the annual Florida Coastal Cleanup. And so it's great to be here. You see all of these folks that are here, all dressed in their warm winter wear, and they're all excited because they know today they get to go out and help clean up our beaches, which they know is really going to directly help wildlife.
This has been a long-standing tradition at Walt Disney World and with our cruise line. In fact, this event started in 1993, and since that time, we've collected over 38,000 pounds of trash out here. This began as a tradition with Walt Disney. You know, he always supported volunteerism and the environment, and that tradition continues. And our cast members are very proud of coming out and helping contribute to the community.
Well, we found bottle caps. We found a lot of cigarette butts, of course. We found some fishing line. A lot of different things. We found a lot of paper, a lot of plastic, just a lot of things that aren't healthy and safe on a beach.
The big thing that with so many volunteers that come out at one time is a beach, you know, every day new trash is entering the system, and we're educating people about not doing that, but we constantly have to be vigilant to get that material out of the ecosystem. So a day like today where we have hundreds of Disney volunteers, they are directly benefiting the wildlife that's right here on my home beach in Cocoa Beach.
I found this tiny little piece of plastic and it's got a very sharp edge to it. And this is the reason we come out here and clean, because if a bird or a fish swallow this, that could be very dangerous. So this is the kind of stuff that we are so glad that you come and help with.
Today to release four of our Kemp's Ridleys at Canaveral National Seashore. They were actually found cold stunned due to the water temperature dropping drastically. And since these guys are exotherms, they're the whatever temperature the water is, and it affects them and it actually causes them to get sick and stop swimming, and they are found and rescued on the beaches. Luckily for us, the cold stunning event, all we really have to do with these sea turtles is get them warmed back up because they're whatever temperature the water happens to be. So these guys were really low maintenance, which was great for them and for us. So we basically had to get them back on track to eating. And once they started eating, they started healing up the superficial scars that they had. And once the water temperature got back to being warm enough for us to release them, that's why we get to release them here today. Disney has been rehabilitating sea turtles for a very long time. Ever since 1986, we have actually released over 300 animals.
African cats,
chimpanzee. Disney Nature brings to the big screen epic stories, starring the wild creatures of our planet. Stories with drama, humor, triumph, and unforgettable characters like Mara, Freddy, and Oscar. And from the very beginning, Disney Nature has committed itself to making a meaningful difference in the world. And we've made the Disney Nature audience our partners. For every ticket purchased opening week to see a Disney Nature film, moviegoers are participating with a portion of their ticket going to help our planet and its wild creatures through special programs coordinated by the Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund, with growing emphasis on connecting a new generation to nature.
It would be utterly useless in my continuing to try and save chimpanzees if we're not raising new generations to be better stewards than we've been.
And now, Disney Nature is proud to announce our next motion picture event, Bears, coming to theaters to celebrate Earth Day 2014.
What we're trying to do is to take people to one of the most beautiful landscapes on our planet, Alaska, and engage them in a really emotional story about one of the most iconic animals on our planet, the grizzly bear.
Our filmmakers will transport audiences to the remote and untamed shores of the Alaskan wild for a stunning yet intimate look into the lives of grizzly bear families.
Grizzly bears are probably one of the most intelligent animals on our planet. That they're social, gentle creatures.
You've got great, iconic animals in a perfect scenic backdrop. I mean, what more could you ask for?
Sea turtles have been coming to lay their eggs on our beaches in Florida long before the dinosaurs were even walking around. Florida is home to more nesting loggerhead sea turtles than just about any place else on Earth. And so our beaches here in Florida are very, very critical when it comes to conserving loggerhead sea turtle. A female sea turtle is about 20 to 30 years old when she comes to nest for the first time. She will lay between 100 to 120 ping pong size eggs into that nest cavity. And it's the most amazing thing to watch. Once she's finished, she's going to turn around and head back to the ocean. Lights are a real issue for sea turtles. When females are coming to nest at night, they're looking for a nice, dark, quiet place to lay their egg. And when the little hatchlings emerge about 2 months later, imagine 100 to 120 little hatchlings coming out of the nest, and it looks like a little volcano erupting full of little baby sea turtles. What they're looking for is the moon shining on the water. And the hatchlings make their way to the ocean, and they go as fast as they possibly can. Once they hit the water, they are going to swim for about 24 to 48 hours. They call it a swim frenzy because they're trying to get out as far as possible and not be visible to predators. If there are lights shining behind them, they will head towards the brightest light that they can see, so they may end up in the dunes and never make it back to the ocean.
So when hatchlings emerge and they make their way to the water, they start looking for the floating sargassum or seaweed that's just floating on the surface. But unfortunately, one of the things that we're finding is that seaweed and sargassum is full of lots of plastic and trash. The little sea turtles will start to take bites, and that's how the plastic ends up in their bellies.
Disney's Animal Programs monitors 7 miles of beach on the east coast of Florida near Disney's Vero Beach Resort. We work very closely with both state and federal agencies to help protect sea turtles. So we'll go in after the eggs have hatched, and we'll count how many actually hatched and how many eggs didn't hatch. And the great thing about it is that we have a very high survival rate on our beach.
We also participate in a program created by the Sea Turtle Conservancy called Tour de Turtles.
It's a great opportunity for you when you're not here at Disney's Vero Beach Resort to be able to track turtles online. So we're going to have 2 turtles in this race. And the whole point is, where do sea turtles go after they finish laying their eggs?
Each of those turtles gets to swim for a specific cause, and these are all causes that are challenges for sea turtle survival. There's not a lot of space left for sea turtles. Places where they can come and lay their eggs, our beaches, are declining as well. The team at Disney's Animal Kingdom in the Seas with Nemo and Friends has nursed more than 300 endangered sea turtles back to health and released them back to the wild. The Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund has directed more than $1.1 million to sea turtle conservation efforts. At Walt Disney World, we're very committed to making a difference for wildlife and wild places and getting the next generation involved in caring for wildlife. We're going to get the sea turtles for you to take a look at, and it's going to be really tough to see. So our work has really been about educating people and protecting our beaches so that sea turtles will continue to have a future in the wild.
This is a spin-off from one of our projects. It started with elephant population work, where we were working here actually for about 10 years doing population work on elephants. And as we all know, when you're doing conservation work, you need to be connecting with the communities that impact those animals directly. And so we started working in the communities around Penda, and we're actually working with educators.
So we're teaching interpretation methods to the teachers in the local community here, and we've taken the interpretive methods that we use for our informal education in the theme parks, and we've brought it here to the educators in this local community.
Conservation education is very important. It taught us as educators that it is very important to teach our learners to take care of the environment, because we depend on each other for healthy lifestyle.
Most of the school, we tend to use the traditional method where the teacher tells all the time. And I think it was an eye-opener for most of the teachers who were there that it's fun and it's more memorable if you learn using games and you know, concentrating on all the learning styles that we can use as teachers in our classrooms.
We spend a week with them doing the training, and then the end of the workshop is a game drive with these educators.
So just as, like we notice when our guests go on Kilimanjaro safaris, it creates those magical moments when our guests see the elephants and the lions and the giraffes. Well, we're bringing that to the educators or the teachers in this community.
Wow, I said to myself, it's real. This is a beautiful thing that we do have animals. We do have these big five animals that we use to see in pictures. They are real, they are there. They are our neighbors.
I couldn't believe it. I see a lion for the first time.
I don't know if it was a male or a female, but he just came like he was coming straight to me. And I prayed silently.
We must change the behavior of the human beings around in our area.
What you do on a conservation lesson on Disney animal program, you do it to the teachers, they take it to the kids they take it to their homes, and they talk about it when they sit with their grandmothers and their mothers and their fathers. That, you know, that's the sense of attitude changes altogether. Yeah.
In whatever animal, it needs to be respected just like I like to be. Even if these animals are just part of us and we're part of them, we need them as they need us. So we've even created the song through that workshop. The song is, when I hear it, I forget. When I see it, I remember.
When I do it, I will learn.
Hi, I'm Melissa. When our family goes on vacation, we try to reduce our impact on the environment, just like at home. If you're like us, every time we leave the room, we turn off the lights, turn off the ceiling fan, television, and coffee maker. Recycle our cans, newspapers, and bottles. Make sure the faucets are turned all the way off. Close patio or balcony doors or windows. Place our towels on the rack to reuse them for the next day. And set our thermostat back. These little things help us do our part to keep it a green world after all. Check.
We're going to be collecting and staging roughly 100 corals today that we're going to then take out to Snapper Ledge and try to plant. First time's at the nursery, cleaning, getting corals ready to go out there. As soon as we get that done, we're going to get up in the boat, drive out to Snapper Ledge, start planting.
All right, we're jumping in.
When we were a fledgling little organization trying to find somebody that would pay attention to us, Disney paid attention. They gave us a grant. They have funded our program for 5 years now.
We're a marine studies class at Coral Shores High School.
We're learning about like corals and what kind of effects there are on them in the ocean.
For us especially, this is our home. This is a big part of our economy. Fish and other organisms depend on these corals, and we just need to do what we can as Keys residents to help out.
The beauty of the reef is just one of the greatest things about it. I mean, I love coming out here and getting to see everything that I get to see, and I want other people to be able to see that too.
Guys, the pool is open. Let's go diving.
The idea of fragmenting and transplanting corals came from the aquarium industry, and I was in that business. I just kind of realized, hey, if they can do it in an aquarium, maybe I could do it in the ocean. We cut them into little pieces, put monofilament around them, suspend them from a tree is what we call them. And after about 6 months to 9 months, that coral is ready to go out on the reef.
The corals that we brought up are actually going to be transported in these white bins to another reef. And what we're going to do is epoxy them to the reef. When we plant them, we put them in these thickets, and what that's going to allow is when these corals start growing, they're going to continue to fuse into one another and create this really great 3D habitat and structure for all these reef fishes and little invertebrates. It's really awesome.
We're focusing in the Caribbean on mostly staghorn and elkhorn coral. They used to be common throughout the Caribbean, and they're about 90 to 95% of them have died over the last 30 years. All coral reefs are under a lot of stress. There's overfishing, changing climate, which is causing the summers to be warmer. All of them are a problem, but we have an opportunity now to make a difference and to change the course of coral reefs. We like to involve students of all ages. If we can get these kids involved at an early age, you know, high school, there's a lot of kids that, after going through a year of our program, they're ready to change their major and become, you know, marine biologists or marine policy people or whatever it is. And so that's exciting for us.
We give them an idea of why we've got a problem, and then we give them a little bit of what we're doing to help solve that and let them actually realize that they're sort of writing the next chapter in this.
We study all the stuff in the classroom, but then they get to come out here and get their hands right into the middle of it and see what's going on firsthand. I don't think you can get any better experience than that.
There you go.
We've given them an appreciation for nature, and we're trying to give this message of hope and a message of there's something that can be done.
So thank you, Disney, for all of your support. And thank you, all the Disney patrons, for supporting this program.
Wait till you're announced. We've not yet lost all our graces. The hounds will stay in chains. Look upon your greatness and you'll send the call out. 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 Send the call out.
We live in cities.
2015, Disney Nature invites you on an unforgettable adventure never before captured on film.
So there.
Disney Nature's Monkey Kingdom.
We're on each other's team.
Dropping into theaters Earth Day 2015.
Hey guys, Olivia Holt here to tell you about my new big project. I'm so excited, I can't wait any longer. I gotta let you guys in on it. Ready? This is gonna raise the roof. For my next big project, I'm going
outside!
Today I'm enjoying time in the great outdoors with some new friends from the Boys and Girls Club.
Being outside is the world's best not-so-secret secret. Just look and listen. I gotta say it, outside is totally in. We don't all live in a forest, but there are green spaces close to everyone.
There are more than 400 national parks in the U.S., covering over 84 million acres, and they belong to all of us. But even in our own backyards, there's one beautiful thing after another to be inspired by. Go for a hike, have a picnic, or just let loose and have a lot of fun. There's nothing to stop any of us from enjoying being outside. It's just on the other side of your door. It's the perfect place to hang out with your family, a friend, or a whole bunch of friends. So if you're looking for the next big thing, open your door and explore. Head to disney.com/friends to find more ways to have fun in the great outdoors. Because
outside is in!
Woo!
So when we get down to it, we've got a winner. Great work here, Walt Disney World Resort. Congratulations. The work that Walt Disney World Resorts is doing with the 70,000 cast members here in Central Florida is incredible and really rose above the competition to showcase how great companies do great things for great people.
We are extremely proud of our cast, and to be able to get them engaged with the goals we're working towards is key to our success.
This legacy started with Walt Disney himself, and thanks to all of our cast members, we're able to grow our commitment to that legacy every day. And that includes doing small things that when you add them up together become big things, like turning off equipment when it's not necessary, or doing bigger things like looking for innovative solutions to energy efficient lighting within our attractions or across the entire resort.
That's how we get our results. There's not one thing, not one magic bullet that we've used, but by a lot of hard work and everybody looking at every piece of the equation, when you put it all together, you can achieve some really great results.
We are especially proud to receive this award because it recognizes the long-standing commitment that our company has had to the environment, to conservation, and to the natural world.
Welcome to the Veterinary Hospital here at Disney's Animal Kingdom. My name is Dr. Scott, and I am one of the veterinarians here. So you guys are all very anxiously waiting. You're here on a very good morning to see Assisi. Assisi is a 16-year-old female gorilla that is new to Disney's Animal Kingdom. Again, she's 16 years old, and she is in quarantine right now. She'll spend 30 days in quarantine. This is her entrance medical exam. So when she comes here to Disney's Animal Kingdom, we want to make sure that she's good and healthy. She'll finish out her quarantine, and then she'll get introduced to the gorilla family group. And so today what you're seeing is basically the team is in our x-ray room, and they're taking a number of x-rays to make sure that she's completely healthy. Right now they're focusing primarily on her chest. When we move out here, we will eventually be coming right out here to finish the exam where the team will continue to work on her. There will be at least two veterinarians working on her, possibly three, several veterinary technicians, and then several of the caretakers for the gorilla on a day-to-day basis because they really know her the best. She is obviously under general anesthesia, which means she's completely asleep. Now, just for your information, Azizi was actually trained to take a hand injection. So we didn't use a dart gun on Azizi this morning. She actually voluntarily gave us her kind of shoulder blade area, and her keeper was able to give her an injection. There's several kids out there that probably wouldn't do that voluntarily. So that helps us to minimize the amount of anesthesia we need and makes the entire procedure much, much calmer. So from a cardiac monitoring, she's on an ECG, so an EKG, what people are used to hearing. The blood pressure, both direct and indirect. Hopefully we'll get to the direct. It's very common for us just to use indirect, which is the cuff that most people are used to. If we get the direct, great, but it's not essential. Let's see, what else? She's on a pulse ox. So she's on what we call a pulse oximeter that measures blood oxygenation and heart rate. And I think that's probably the extent. I think that's primarily what we're doing from a cardiac perspective. And then of course the x-rays to evaluate her chest and lung function. And so far so good, everything looks really great on Azizi, who is our 16-year-old female that's getting her quarantine exam today. Thank you guys, thank you for visiting us here at the hospital.
Hey guys, we're going behind the scenes of Disney Nature's Monkey Kingdom. A brand new movie about a pretty unique family who stick together through some crazy adventures.
To bring their story to the big screen, one brave film crew traveled deep into the jungles of South Asia to a lost city that this family calls home.
You can see them behind me.
They're everywhere.
Now this kingdom is pretty wild, but luckily the crew was still able to fit in.
Sometimes the monkeys even tried to help out.
Hey, hey, we're the monkeys.
Lucky monkeys. But they aren't the only animals in this kingdom. These guys have friends in lots of places.
You can take a walk on the wild side in Disney Nature's Monkey Kingdom, coming to theaters April 17th, rated G.
Here's where you can help. See Monkey Kingdom opening week, and Disney Nature will make a donation in your honor to Conservation International to help protect monkeys and other endangered species in their natural habitats.
My name is Dr. M. Sanjan, and I'm a Disney Nature Ambassador and conservation scientist supporting conservation programs around the world. Where I'm standing right now, Disney Nature's brand new film, Monkey Kingdom, was filmed. Let's go take a look.
Here are the monkeys of Monkey Kingdom.
That's Castle Rock right behind me, the heart of where Monkey Kingdom was filmed.
Once upon a time, right here was this huge human kingdom. Now it's been taken over by the Monkey Kingdom.
He came right by me. He came right by me.
Wow!
From Castle Rock, you can see the entire kingdom. See if there's any danger coming their way. This whole rock is just filled with this macaque troop all around me. And they've got this incredible tree where the monkeys hide out. You can clearly tell why this is the kingdom of the monkeys. Pretty cool, huh?
Disney Channel's Corey and Tenzing are monkeying around and want to introduce you to the stars of Disney Nature's Monkey Kingdom.
Get ready to hang out with one wild family.
There's Kip, the kid.
Nice job, Corey.
Yes! And his mom, Maya.
They're all on an incredible adventure.
That was awesome.
Monkeys love to have a good time, play with friends, and be, well, monkeys. Meet Kip. He loves to goof around, and he knows that even the toughest guys need a cuddle. Disney Nature's Monkey Kingdom, in theaters April 17th, rated G.
We have the recreation site here in the spring. People love coming here. There's people out here with boats right now, and certain weekends it gets very hectic. So we got together kind of wondering, how do we keep the recreation activities going while we still protect the environment here?
This site in particular receives, I think I was told, up to 300 people a day on a weekend day. Being close to Lake George, it's used by boaters and fishermen. It's also a really important manatee conservation area. And so with those competing interests, that was the intention of the National Forest Foundation's work with the Silver Glen Springs Collaborative, to address all of those different interests and come up with a management plan that would really satisfy all those different needs.
As president of the Juniper Club, I was asked to get involved with the work group, being property owners across the glen from the Forest Service property. We're neighbors. We run from the Silver Glen all the way down to the Juniper River. So it was a great opportunity for us to get involved with any potential change or management of the glen.
The Cedar Shore Alliance has been a part of the Silver Glen Working Group from the conception. What we are trying to do is actually provide the scientific aspect.
Part of our work group has been Monica Ross with Cedar Shore, and she has been very kind to take the time to educate us and our members. I have learned more about the manatees in the last few years than I ever thought I would. Knowing that there's going to be use of the glen, it needs to be managed for that. The U.S. Forest Service has done a real good job of working with all the other groups to make sure all the angles were covered.
For the stakeholder group to be effective, we had to have a neutral facilitator, and the Disney Conservation Fund was able to provide that through the National Forest Foundation.
Disney's funding really enabled the NFF to move forward with this project, and without that support, this really wouldn't have happened.
We want people to use the National Forest, but we need to make sure that it's protected. And that was part of the group's focus, was to try to find that blend of protecting the run and the spring, but also providing so people could use it.
Stewardship and nature conservation are a rich part of Disney's history and a vital focus of our future. From our earliest nature films through the creation of the Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund, caring for our planet will always be a part of what makes Disney, Disney.
Disney started a program called the Climate Solutions Fund, which invests in projects that will reduce greenhouse gases, and we're doing projects all around the world.
We're located in the Peninsular Mountain Range. It's a little gem of 25,000 acres, within 3 hours' drive of about 15 million people. Right now, we're at the top of Middle Peak in Cuyamaca Rancho State Park, and this is an area that used to be a sky island. Forest habitat here, mixed conifers, and they used to be as tall and majestic, straight and thick as that area back down there where the trees are still standing.
There was a great fire that swept through this state park and through San Diego County called the Cedar Fire, and it engulfed 98% of the state park.
The fire was so hot that it got up into the trees, what we call a crown fire, meaning that it burned everything from the ground all the way to the very tops of the trees and killed all the cones, killed all the seeds, and burned the soil so much that any of the seed that was in the soil was destroyed.
So they never would have regenerated naturally. And in order to get conifers back in this area, the park decided they needed to plant them.
These are the seedlings that we're planting. This is a Jeffrey pine, and these are native to this area. The planters are a professional planting crew. They can plant almost 1,000 seedlings a day.
The little seedlings that are now 6 inches tall, in 10 years, maybe 10 to 12 feet tall. And during that time, they will sequester carbon from the atmosphere and store it within themselves.
The greenhouse gases we reduce today, we may not see the impact for 20, 30, 40, 50 years, but you gotta do them now.
We have about 16,000 school children that come through the park, and some of those come through the Cuyamaca Outdoor School Camp.
We teach the kids about what happened and why the state parks is involved in reforestation, learning that everybody can have a positive impact on the environment, no matter how small that is.
The cedar fire that went through in 03 really upset the balance of this place, and it would be great to see it back in its state, and hopefully this project will do a lot to further that goal.
I would just like to say thank you to the people at Disney who have helped to make this project a reality. And I'd especially like to thank the experts on the reforestation team who are guiding this project and making this restoration effort a success.
At Disney, we are dedicated to protecting nature and to helping create a brighter tomorrow for generations to come.
You know what I think? I think every day should be Earth Day. We all love to go outside, and the national parks are the perfect place to celebrate the Earth. Join Friends for Change and the National Park Foundation and get outdoors! Planning your trip is easy. First, pick a park. There are over 400 national parks and thousands of state parks in the U.S. You can even explore the outdoors at a local park near you. Then prepare for adventure and get ready to play! Hang out! Explore! Hide! Seek! Final step, document your trip. Take lots of pictures and share them with your friends. Go to disney.com/friendsforchange for more information on planning your great outdoor adventure. Because shouldn't every day be Earth Day?
On this planet we call home, with every new generation, the torch is passed. Instinctively, parents teach their children to be a part of this incredible world of ours. From the story of Bambi to the latest Disney nature film, the natural world is in our Disney heritage. And caring for our planet will always be part of what makes Disney, Disney. We inspire conservation by connecting families with the wonder of nature. Through engaging programs, entertaining storytelling, and unique experiences. We help animals through a core of more than 600 Disney scientists, animal care specialists, vets, and educators devoted to making a difference. We are dedicated to protecting nature. Through our climate program, we are committed to reducing our environmental impact by using our resources wisely and investing in forests around the world. And grants from the Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund support people and programs making a positive impact on nature in 110 countries. So join us in helping make our world a better place and creating a brighter tomorrow.
We're excited to have you here out in Everglades National Park. You're up for a pretty cool day today. We're really excited about the Ticket to Ride grant program with Disney and the National Park Foundation because it has allowed many students that would not have had the opportunity to come out and explore the national parks that are in their backyard. There's actually a nest right in front of us, a fish nest.
It was exactly what we needed, transportation in order to bring kids up from the Florida Keys to Everglades National Park.
Unfortunately, we actually live very close to the Everglades, and many of them have never been here. So this has been a wonderful opportunity today because between funding and everything else, we just can't get them out here.
I like the wilderness, and I like just exploring everything.
I think it's really important to get kids outside and get in tune with nature. They may be able to read some things in books, but there's no comparison to the hands-on experiences that they get when they come out to national parks.
When you're out here, it's like so quiet and so calm.
To me, you can't bring nature to the school. You have to go out and see it in the whole. You might be able to bring a bird, but you can't see the bird doing what it normally does.
I've learned about cypress survivals,
sawgrasses.
They remember so much more when they're out here. And, you know, you go back to the classroom and they write about it, they write so much more, their pictures are more detailed.
It's really exciting to see by the end of the day how excited they are to be here and how excited they are to come back.
I am so grateful to Disney and to the National Parks Foundation for putting together this fabulous grant program to do this essential work of getting kids outside.
There were a couple of persons, literally a couple, who were fascinated by this snake that we were said to have had, but no one has seen it in many, many years. And as a matter of fact, another researcher said it's gone extinct. So they went to the island, and lo and behold, they found a snake. These persons now made contact with other researchers, in particular from Fauna and Flora International.
FFI was the first international conservation organization, founded in 1903. We work to conserve threatened species and habitats worldwide, and we currently work in about 50 countries. In 1995, my organization was asked to come to Antigua to try and help save the world's rarest snake. A small number were discovered on Great Bird Island, a small island off Antigua. And in a way, it seemed like a second chance to save a species from extinction. A long time ago, the Antiguan racer used to live all over Antigua and Barbuda, probably numbering in the millions. But then, to help control the rat population, mongooses were introduced to the country, and the Antiguan racers very quickly died out, and the only place they survived was Great Bird Island.
We reached out to Disney saying, hey, we think we can help bring this snake back. Disney said, we'd like to help.
Once we started the project, we realized that it's very important to have accurate data on every snake because the population is so small.
Oh, she's a nice one.
All right, we actually caught this snake already in 2012.
Okay.
The last time we took her mass, she was 230 grams.
She's actually grown a bit. There were only 50 Antiguan races when I first came to Antigua. Now, over the years, though, we've been able to help increase the population through the education programs we've been doing, through the restoration projects we've been doing. And the snake populations are now increasing. We've managed to reintroduce them to three more little islands off Antigua. And the numbers have climbed from about 50 to around about 1,000.
We moved them up to Green Island, which is another island. We have quite a few other offshore islands, which is in the same area. I assist by moving the snake back and forth, and sometimes I help catch them as well.
As our project's grown, we've been addressing many of the other issues within this whole ecosystem on the land and in the sea. We're not just working on the snake now, we're working on birds and on turtles and other things. We also restore habitat, so we've restored 13 islands off Antigua, and this is benefiting many, many other species.
I hope that we can restore as many islands as possible so we can have a lot of the islands looking like great birds. Without Disney, it would not have been possible. I mean, we have a lot of committed volunteers, but still, we need material, we need equipment, and Disney was able to supply us with that, and we're thankful.
Look at all the stuff in the sky like a kite. Children are a really, really important part of this program. We like to go around schools showing them the Antiguan races and bringing them out to the islands and teaching them about the snakes and also teaching them about this amazing natural heritage.
You guys with me?
Yeah.
All right.
What we found is that it's easier to get the kids involved in environmental work because they're young, excited, they want to learn new things, and it's just great getting them to learn about their natural environment. So who has seen the racer before?
Their eyes are staring. Look, those big eyes. They can't blink. They can't close their eyes.
That's because they have no eyelids.
They have no eyelids. So even when they're asleep, their eyes are wide open.
Open. Just like this. Has
anybody seen the big brown bug?
With the floating classroom program, we're basically trying to educate the young children so that they can take those lessons through life and they go home and they tell their parents.
Because we're the caretakers of the planet, it's important that we let future generations realize we have to take care of everything, even a snake.
The racer snake is very, very rare. I think it's the only place you can find it in the world, in Antigua. And to keep that alive, that's something wonderful.
When I first came to Disney's Animal Kingdom as a zoological manager for the aviaries here, other than taking care of our birds here at the park, I'm also interested in the wild birds around us, and I love purple martins. And so I made a proposal to the company and asked them if they would sponsor putting up purple martin houses and starting a purple martin colony. And the first year we had 6 pairs show up the first year, and we were very happy about that. We had 36 chicks that first year. Now, I don't know how many we're going to have this year, but it'll be in the hundreds. As it grows, we talk to people about them. There's also other martin houses on property here at Epcot. So there's a lot of opportunity for our guests to view them and realize that they can actually have these birds around their house and invite nature into their lives.
We want to track these birds because they're declining across their range, and we don't really know where they spend the rest of their year when they're not here with us in North America. And our aim is to track purple martins from their breeding colonies here and in other sites in North America and follow their migration all the way down through the Caribbean and Central America all the way to where they spend the winter in South America, mostly in Brazil. Purple martin take really readily to human-made structures like this for nesting. In fact, that's almost exclusively what they breed in now in the Northeast, so humans have a really important role to play in the nesting habitat for the species. So we're tracking purple martins and lots of other songbirds with a device called a light level geolocator. So this is what it looks like here. And it's just a little electronic device that has a light reader here that sticks up between the feathers of the bird. So it records light levels throughout the day. So from this we can get sunrise and sunset times. We can get a daily fix on where it is just based on the light levels that this device records.
Purple martins are a good species because other birds and other animals live in those areas too, and if we can identify areas to protect, they can also help protect a whole suite of other birds and animals at the same time.
The Walt Disney Company has an amazing commitment to protecting habitats around the world. And as part of a program that we have done with the Nature Conservancy, we've planted more than 3 million trees in Brazil. Wouldn't it be wonderful to see our purple martins enjoying these habitats that we're trying to protect?
That's our goal here, is to really spread the word and just get people involved, because if they love nature, they love birds, they'll want to protect them and they'll want to protect the earth.
On this planet we call home, with every new generation, the torch is passed. Instinctively, parents teach their children to be a part of this incredible world of ours. From the story of Bambi to the latest Disney nature film, the natural world is in our Disney heritage. And caring for our planet will always be part of what makes Disney, Disney. We inspire conservation by connecting families with the wonder of nature. Through engaging programs, entertaining storytelling, and unique experiences. We help animals through a core of more than 600 Disney scientists, animal care specialists, vets, and educators devoted to making a difference. We are dedicated to protecting nature. Through our climate program, we are committed to reducing our environmental impact by using our resources wisely and investing in forests around the world. And grants from the Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund support people and programs making a positive impact on nature in 110 countries. So join us in helping make our world a better place and creating a brighter tomorrow.
Shouldn't every day really be Earth Day? Isn't this wonderful place worth celebrating over and over again? Because if you're anything like me, what you really, really want to do is go outside and play! Our national parks are great places to go and celebrate planet Earth, with over 400 national parks covering 84 million acres in the U.S. alone, and thousands of state and regional parks, the possibilities are endless. So grab your family and go for a hike, go camping, go for a day, for 3 days, or for just an hour. Let's just go! Go outside! Go outside! Go outside! Visit disney.com/friendsforchange for more information on how to make every day Earth Day.
Grace is focusing on the rehabilitation of the Growers gorillas and on education.
Growers gorillas are found nowhere else in the world except in the Democratic Republic of Congo. So they are very special.
Their families have been poached. If they come from Rwanda, it's not because they have been seized in Rwanda. They have been seized in Congo.
They came across to be company for the mountain gorillas, so they'd sort of grow up to be a gorilla group. You have this highly endangered, very slow reproducing species that's very susceptible to human diseases in this very defined habitat with no buffer zones. You take sort of every conservation theme and it's sort of magnified to the, you know, to the highest level here. And now the Grauris are moving back into their native DRC into a very nice situation.
It was long with many helps, many ideas, people were really dedicated to make this possible.
From building the facility to actually transporting the gorillas has taken the collaboration of the Fosse Fund, the Mountain Gorilla Veterinary Project, as well as Disney, IFAW, a cast of hundreds of people working together. It took all of these groups to move 6 gorillas.
Gorillas are one of the shining examples of cross-border collaboration between Rwanda and Congo. Even moments where the political situation has been tense, the people in the field and the institutions that are working with gorillas have been able to work together.
When I saw the helicopter come over the hill and start hovering above the facility, I thought I would cry. It was a very emotional experience.
Well, GRACE is a unique project. GRACE was set up as a gorilla rehabilitation project, and it has always been the objective to release gorillas into the wild.
Some confidence can be built now on the ability of all the organizations involved on going forward and doing the reintroduction. The reintroduction has never been done before. This is a pioneering exercise, and certainly there's a lot of challenges ahead, but I think this successful move gives us a good base to move on.
All of our caretakers here at GRACE are from this area. Getting to work with them, they tell us, is just so special, they don't even know how to put to words.
We've watched them grow, and yet there had never been a successful introduction that lasted to puberty and reproduction. That's a process that's really going to have to take off at GRACE.
Since those gorillas will come this evening, when we will be sure that 6 of them are here, I think I will dream very good this night.
Gave us all of this land and said we could build the facility here for 15 gorillas. It's just now finished and we have 13.
So it's not a center to keep growers, gorillas in captivity. It's aimed to release them and increase the population.
They are more likely to call GRACE, Dying Fossey Gorilla Fund, or ICCN so we can move fast and confiscate the baby.
Working with the local communities to create spaces within their tribal areas for gorilla conservation. We're also fighting against bushmeat, which is one major source of grouse gorilla decline.
Ihomi was confiscated 4 days after he was taken from the wild. The gorilla who arrived before Ihomi, that was Lubutu, and he was kept in captivity for quite a while.
They can only be saved by the Congolese. And we just guide them and provide support they need to really rehabilitate these animals and put them back in the wild. They have a treasure that is found nowhere else in the world.
If I can see them one day having babies, living long, that's my wish, my hope for them.
One of the biggest barriers for a teacher to be able to bring a school out on a field trip is the funding for the buses. And with the Ticket to Ride grant through Disney and the National Park Foundation, we've just taken one of the major barriers away.
We're less than 60 miles from the Great Smokies, from where we are at our School of Inquiry and Life Sciences at Asheville. And I would still say at least a third of my students have never been to the Great Smoky Mountains before. For the first part of the bus drive, they are loud and just excited to be off campus. And then as we slowly bring ourselves up the mountain, you know, all of a sudden there's just sort of a quiet that comes across, and as soon as we break through that tree line and sort of get to the top where we start to be able to see the cabin, and we actually get to the learning center, you just sort of start to see their eyes widen a little bit.
Even though they grow up in these mountains, they don't often get that vista. So we often hear, oh, it's like the sound of music when they step off the bus.
For me, it's just really important, particularly as a science teacher, to not only be getting out of the classroom for science and to be collecting real data, but also to give students a little bit of an opportunity to sort of be connecting with nature and some of the outdoor topics that we spend time talking about in the classroom.
What's really cool is you all actually help out with research while you're here. We're going to be having you collect data for two actual real research studies, and we're going to be keeping your data. So we're very, very excited that you all are here.
We have them.
In the classroom, we might talk about some of the environmental issues, anything from acid rain to climate change. But until they start to get a firsthand look at some of the things that they might be losing along the way, it's hard for them to have enough of a connection for them to care about those things.
We learned about how we actually affect the environment, that pollution actually does have an effect, and it's not just the small effect that we've always thought it has, it's bigger than that.
Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund enables so many projects in so many corners of the world. It has also really helped communities in those areas to understand the value of what they have.
We have set up a chimpanzee sanctuary for the orphan rescued chimpanzees on an island called Ngamba Island Chimpanzee Sanctuary. With this program, we have conservation education, we have habitat monitoring, and community development projects.
Today we are going to learn about forests and the challenges facing wildlife in the forests we have in Chaligambire. What are some of the challenges, problems facing animals in the forest?
Hunting.
Hunting? Have you seen it?
It's very important to work with children because they are the future. Disney has supported us at the sanctuary. In addition to that, we had 120 energy-saving stoves.
We are appreciating for this program from Chimpanzee Sanctuary, which is helping our pupils to gain the skills in making stoves to the community.
The Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund has been really instrumental in crane conservation around the world. We've had a whole series of grants that have supported really important conservation work for the four resident crane species in Africa, all four of which are endangered.
We are now involved in crane and wetland conservation in the North Rift and western part of Kenya.
This project is about conservation of the wetland, and not only the wetland, also cranes, because cranes breed in the wetland. So we give them the goats in exchange for coming out from the wetland.
When you grow up, you will be responsible for these particular fragile ecosystems, for we all need to coexist with the cranes to ensure the future generation will also inherit some good, well-preserved environment.
Disney Fund has also supported work for Siberian cranes, a critically endangered crane species.
The survival of the Siberian crane is based on the conservation of wetlands. The majority of all Siberian cranes alive in the world congregated at this single wetland complex in Momogi Nature Reserve.
They pause, it's about halfway point on the migration, basically refuel. They only like to feed in shallow water and wet mud, and they're feeding on roots of aquatic plants.
Through a carefully designed management plan, water has been provided to these wetlands, and the cranes have responded by showing up.
The Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund has been having an amazing impact, and we want to see that impact grow in years to come.
I've never actually seen a shark in real life, so I think it'd be really cool to see a shark.
I'm kind of scared, but I think learning more about them will help me appreciate them more and what they actually do for the ecosystem rather than just being afraid of them.
I'm really, really terrified of them.
A lot of times we have kids that have never seen the ocean, never been on the ocean, never seen a shark except in a movie where the shark's eating people, you know? So for them to see sharks as they really are, you know, just majestic and beautiful, changes a lot of the kids' perspectives.
So you're gonna be surrounded by nature your whole life. You might as well get to know it now.
Right now we are in the northwest corner of Florida Bay within Everglades National Park. We deploy 10 drum lines. We leave that out for about an hour. Then we go recover them. And hopefully there's gonna be some sharks on the other end, and then our team can get busy.
Guys, it's a full shark! You come down the look, you'll see the water rushing through its gills.
The next thing we do, we're gonna take a variety of different measurements on the sharks. And by we, I mean you.
Okay, let's get measuring.
We bring out students, primarily high school, out on the boat with us to participate in these practical, hands-on, real research. The goal of that is to get these kids excited about science and research, and also to help them develop a conservation ethic, become stewards of the oceans and of sharks.
We brought out 1,400 kids last year. If we do that every year, we're gonna have an army of people who care about the ocean and wanna see better things for it.
To go out on a small boat and do your science is one thing. The other thing is to charter a big boat that can bring 20 kids. And the support from organizations like the Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund allows this to happen. One of the biggest reasons that sharks globally are declining is that they're being fished and targeted just for their fins. So part of our work is to also create an awareness. Their fins are used to make shark fin soup. We conducted a study with the University of Miami's Medical School, and what we discovered is that the shark fins contain a neurological toxin linked with Alzheimer's, dementia, and ALS diseases. We provided that information to NGOs, the public, and that's helping lower the demand for shark fin soup. So that's a way that we've seen our work get to the source, the human behavior. This is a satellite tag. It looks like a little submarine, right? Whenever this breaks the surface, it gives us a position of exactly where that animal is. And in fact, we even upload that information on our website. We have an interactive Google Earth map where people from the public can follow our sharks. By better understanding kind of the forces that drive where they are, we can predict their migrations, their corridors, their feeding grounds, their mating grounds, and we can provide that data to managers, to policymakers, to protect those critical areas.
Look at that tag! She's transmitting!
This project is a great example of community outreach at its best. We have research taking place that's very important for the conservation of sharks, but at the same time, they're focused on reaching out to local schools and getting children involved in the projects.
One of the most rewarding things for me has been mentoring students, bringing them out into the field, and seeing their faces when they actually see a shark for the first time.
Thank you, Disney!
For our next story, we're going to go behind the scenes at Disney's Animal Kingdom to talk about one of the best-known animals in the world, the African elephant.
African elephants are really interesting animals. They're highly social and live in family units headed by a female matriarch. The trunk that they possess is actually a great sound amplifier. Elephants have a wide variety of vocal sounds, some of which are so low in pitch, we can't hear them with our human ears. Here at Disney's Animal Kingdom, we've had the opportunity to eavesdrop on a lot of elephant conversations. It's part of our ongoing study of how elephants communicate. We're now able to use some of our findings here at Disney's Animal Kingdom and apply it to helping elephants in the wild.
In the 20th century, the ivory trade brought African elephant numbers into serious decline. Between 1980 and 1990, the total population fell by half, from 1.3 million to less than 600,000. In Kenya, elephants suffered an 85% decline. An international ban on the ivory trade was declared in 1990, but poaching, for ivory and for meat, still continues. It is estimated that there are between 500 and 700,000 elephants living on the African continent today. But the human population is growing too, and humans and elephants are increasingly competing for land and resources.
In Samburu, Kenya, there's a project called Elephants and Bees, which is trying to stop elephants from raiding farmers' crops. Disney and the conservation group Save the Elephants are working on a solution that involves this other animal, the honeybee.
Bees make a lot of noise whenever an animal comes near their hives, and wildlife observers notice that elephants avoid trees that have beehives. So Disney and Save the Elephants played recordings of bee sounds to elephants and found that elephants are afraid of bees. They run away. This means that bees could be used to discourage elephants from raiding crops of local farmers. People in the community of Ngari Mara are being trained to build beehive fences around their crops, and it protects them from elephants. It's a great example of community involvement in making wise choices to help both elephants and people.
I've made wildlife films on almost every animal on this planet, in almost every habitat on the planet. By far the most challenging is working with chimpanzees in the rainforest.
Chimpanzees have such an enormous potential for the cinema because of the fantastic narrative they offer.
The very first time I worked with chimpanzees, I realized that they were totally fascinating. And the experience you can give people on the big screen is a very powerful one.
The production's been filming over 4 years in the Ivory Coast in West Africa. It's pretty fair to say it's in the middle of nowhere, and in many ways, its remoteness is what's protected it.
Our main location was a 10-hour drive, another 4 hours on a dirt road, which in the rainy season was almost impassable. Then it was a 2-hour walk through a very small path into the center of the forest.
Our camp was designed to allow wildlife to pass through it.
It's basically like the jungle with a roof over it. There are lots of unwelcome visitors that come into your camp. The whip scorpions really are quite gruesome looking creatures. Every now and again you get an army ant raid on the camp. Sometimes you get scorpions on the pathway as well. In the rainforest, there is a wet season, and we had to go there during the wet season.
Not all animals like the rain as well, so you suddenly become this little dry oasis.
And every now and again, snakes come into camp. One of the most venomous and probably the most dangerous one we've had was a rhinoceros viper.
If we'd been bitten, there's almost no chance we would have survived.
The bees are horrendous. Ow!
It's got intolerable. I'm leaving. We're out of here. Had enough.
The rainforest itself is not an easy place to work. The most important thing we did was to choose the best wildlife cameraman in the world. Martin Kolbeck is absolutely the top of his game. The quality of images that he got out of that forest are frankly startling.
This was the most challenging project I've ever done. The canopy is very closed. The vegetation is very thick at ground level. I was always trying to find this little tiny window through the vegetation.
There must be easier ways to make a living, but they're not as much fun.
Bill Wallower is very fast in the forest, and he understands chimpanzees.
The biggest challenge in capturing chimps is to actually move faster than the chimps, predict where they're going to come through, and to keep a safe distance. They're in a life and death situation.
That's very important for the action sequences in the film.
It's pandemonium, those intergroup encounters, and they're really quite frightening because you've got these enormous animals running all around you, screaming, and you don't know what's going on.
At one point, something terrible happens to this little boy's mother.
Oscar, completely on his own in the forest, wouldn't have survived.
You know, when that happened, we thought the film was over. We were about to ring up Disney and say, guys, we haven't got a movie. And then the most unpredictable thing happened, the adoption of our star by Freddy the Alpha Male. Never filmed before in the wild. We were very keen to make sure that the beauty of the rainforest was brought to the big screen.
In order to bring the trees to life, you need to sort of fly the camera through the forest.
We'd put cables in the canopy of the rainforest and ran specially designed cameras that could track through the rainforest in a sort of beautifully smooth shot. On most days, the cameramen will get seconds of footage.
You just live for those golden moments every now and again where it all comes together. And I think it's going to touch people as much as it touched us when we were there filming it.
People often ask you as a wildlife filmmaker, what is your favorite animal? And I always say chimpanzees, and this movie has just confirmed my complete passion for these animals.
Hi! Chata Ann here with my sisters, Lauren and Sierra.
Hi.
We're here to talk about what all of us can do to protect wildlife habitats, like the one in Disney Nature's chimpanzee. You may live thousands of miles away from a rainforest, but that doesn't mean you can't pitch in.
You don't even have to travel. Just look around your house or your community. There are plenty of things you can do, like volunteering for a neighborhood cleanup or even recycling your cell phone when you get a new one.
Everything you do will make a difference. Get your parents' permission and visit disney.com/friendsforchange to learn more about what you and your family can do to preserve wildlife habitats.
When I saw my first cotton top, I thought it was such an incredible animal, so majestic. You wonder why an intelligent person, a human, could harm such a noble animal.
Every time I come to Colombia, I see that more and more forest has been cut. And that's because people who live in these rural communities that surround these forests live in poverty. They don't have a way to support their families. So they end up going into the forest, cutting down trees, capturing monkeys for the illegal pet trade so that they can get money to buy food for their family.
This is a flagship species for the tropical dry forest of the northern region of Colombia. So conserving it means conserving not only other species, but the forest, which is one of the most threatened ecosystems in our country.
We thank Disney's Worldwide Conservation Fund for their support to our community work. One of the biggest accomplishments in the last year has been the building of the Conservation Center in the village of Los Limites, where our Eco Mochila project is based. And by building this conservation center, which is the first center we will have in the region to protect cotton top tamarins, we are going to be able to do much more in expanding our community work and as well as our environmental education programs and being able to reach more people and get them committed to the conservation work we develop in the area.
It's great to see how the community has improved in helping the environment with our work. Everything we talk about has become a reality, and you can see it.
I'm here to tell you that conservation is a long-term investment, and it's a long-term investment because it requires people on the ground that are committed to making a difference for wildlife. And there is a lot of work that needs to be done, particularly in countries where education is not a high priority. The Disney Worldwide Conservation Fund has really changed the lives of kids in Colombia. Before, they had no idea that cotton tops were such a special and important species to save. And now, kids in Colombia care about wildlife, and they're going to make a difference for the future.
Queremos a Disney.